We need to behave more serious from now, right?
Yes, I think so.
But hey, seriously, I hope you in the future can visit us in the campus in person, and we'll welcome you. Come again, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to mute myself. It's all your time.
Hung, when we at 10:30, I'll give a short introduction, and then it'll be all yours.
Hello, just making sure, Jordan, can you hear me? This is Anindya joining in.
Yes, I can hear you.
Hello, Dr. Huang, how are you?
Hello, good morning. I'm good, how are you?
Good, very good to see you.
Very nice to see you.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Purdue Statistics Distinguished Themes Seminar Series on Deep Learning Methods and Theory. We are pleased to have Dr. Hung Fong join us for today's lecture. Hung is currently the John Jurenko Endowed Professor in Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Pittsburgh, and is also a professor in Biomedical Informatics at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. Hung is a leading expert in many areas of machine learning, big data mining, and biomedical data science, and he has published more than 220 papers in top-tier conferences and many papers in top journals as well. Today, Hung will be talking about distributed machine learning. To our viewers, whether you're watching on Zoom or YouTube, you may submit your questions in the chat on either platform. We will monitor the chats and relay the questions to the speaker when it is appropriate. Due to limited time, we may only be able to ask a subset of the questions, and we apologize in advance if your question is omitted. At this point, let's give our full attention to Hung. It's all yours.
Thank you, Jordan. Let me share my screen. Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to give this talk in this deep learning seminar. I'm very glad to introduce our recent work in distributed machine learning, especially related to deep learning models. The algorithm and theorem we developed in this talk. So the major work for in this talk, I have been working with my postdoc, my former postdoc Bing Gu, and my student Zhou Yanghuo, and also An Xu. So in past 10 years, there is a dramatic increasing attention on machine learning and deep learning because they are playing the key roles in everywhere in our life. If we watch movie, we have the recommendation system to recommend movie. And also if we purchase a product from Amazon, Amazon will recommend the product, the related product to us. So this system called recommendation system. So now in current state, the deep learning has the best performance in prediction for recommendation system. Well, we know that the autonomous driving is becoming true in the real world in the next 3 to 5 years. So the deep learning is also the key component in autonomous driving. So in our life, for entertainment, like for game, for movie, deep learning and machine learning technique are playing key roles. The role is become more and more important. And also for computer vision, natural language processing, especially recently in healthcare. For all these areas, machine learning, especially deep learning, are playing more important roles. So deep learning is not a new world, actually. Like 30 years ago, we already have the, we call it deep neural network. Many scientists already considered to design deep neural network. So that's what we call we can call this a big model because model is large. However, deep learning, from my point of view, deep learning has three legs. So on one side, the big model, the deep model is only one component for deep learning. So for deep learning, we need a big data to train the model. So the big data are crucial to train deep neural network to be successful. And meanwhile, because the model is large, data size is large, so we need a bigger computing to support that. So for 30 years ago, although the deep neural network concept was proposed, but at that time, we don't have big data to train the model, and also we don't have the bigger computing technique like cloud computing, high-performance computing, GPU, and the GPU cluster, FPGA. Without all this software and hardware support, so deep learning was not successful 30 years ago. But in recent 10 years, we do have the big model, big data, big computing all happen at the same time. So deep learning is becoming very successful in both academia and in industry. So let's see all these three impact on deep learning. So first, let's see the big model. So this this figure plots that the number of parameter worth the top one accuracy in the ImageNet collaboration, because ImageNet is standard benchmark data set for deep neural network. So we can see that with the number of parameter increase, like now the parameter is extremely huge. We do get a much better accuracy in prediction. So the model, when the model is becoming deeper, so the result is become better. For big data, let's see if when this image tells us when the number of data increase, the labeled plus unlabeled data, the accuracy also increase. For example, for efficient net, they use the labeled 1.2 million of image to train the train neural network to do the classification for image net, get a very good accuracy. However, it's huge, big model. Then if we add on, other unlabeled, like 300 million of unlabeled data, because sometimes we don't have a huge number of labeled data, but we do can use the unlabeled data to enhance the performance. Then the accuracy can be further improved. So based on big model, with the enhancement of big data, the prediction accuracy can be further improved. So this is different to the traditional semi-supervised learning. For traditional semi-supervised learning, for shallow model, if the model already has enough data to cover the distribution of the data point, so the performance may not be increased with adding more unlabeled data. However, for deep learning has it's different story because we have a huge model, so we have a large number of parameters to fit the data. So with adding more unlabeled data, the performance can be further improved. So when we have big model and a big data, we need to solve them on computer or like FPGA device. So we do need the big computing support. Otherwise, we have no way to train the model, or we need to train very long time, like by years. So the big computing is crucial to help big model and big data in deep learning. So at that time, so for individual computer, we have the GPU, TPU to support for deep neural network. Then we have the in recent years we use we call the parallel or distributed machine learning to help the big data for help big data and big model computation in deep neural network. So for example, we have if the data size is super large, so we may have multiple worker. For example, in cloud computing, we have multiple computing different worker, different computer hold partial of data. They do the computation locally, then commute with the parameter server. So the parameter server will synchronous or asynchronously learn the model. After many round iterations, we can learn a merge conversion model to share for all the workers. So such distributed and parallel computing has supported the big data and the big model big model for deep neural network. Oh, I do see. I'm not sure it's a question or not. There is a question about what are the major features in big model? Yeah, the major features is the parameters. Like a big model means like the layer become very deep. So as a beginning, the model will have like maybe 10 layers for deep neural network. Gradually go to 100 layers, even more than that, like several hundred layers, and also the neural network become huge. Its parameter number increased dramatically. So that we call the big model, but that's actually you can consider for deep neural networks now, majority of them are their big model. The other question is, what information is gained by adding unlabeled data? Because the unlabeled data indeed provide certain silent, we call it silent information. So for the same for the object, they do have similarity between the labeled and unlabeled data. So using unlabeled data, we can learn the in computer vision, we call it like a dictionary. Some underlying dictionary. We can, if we use only using labeled data, we may not identify all of them. But combine both labeled and unlabeled data, we could identify more such dictionaries to help us do the prediction. Of course, there's only one. For different scientists, they have different explanations because so far it's still open problem. So it, in my opinion, we didn't really fully understand the deep neural network, and also we don't fully understand why the combination of labeled and unlabeled data will really help the performance. But indeed, the results show that with adding the more a lot of unlabeled data, the result will be better. So far, there are no theoretic proof to tell us the ground truth. To really prove that, most of them based on intuition or some algorithm based interpretation. So in this talk, I will talk about our recent work on distributed machine learning to solve some challenge issues in big data and big model. So for big data, when we do the distributed machine learning to conduct the computing. So there's very high communication overhead. And also the convergence is a big issue. If the convergence rate is slow, then we want to train big data, it takes many, many time. So could be weeks, months, even by years. Okay. Meanwhile, when we train the big data, we the state of the art technique using the large batch training. But the generalization and the convergence of this large batch training is not well understood yet. So we provide a theory to prove that the convergence for the large batch training. For big model, when the deep learning had many, many layers, so one GPU, even one computer cannot hold them. So we need using the winning split model into different the parallel sessions. Different parallel computer or GPUs. So how can we do that without lose accuracy and also without lose convergence? It's very challenging. Actually, our work is the first one can theoretically prove the algorithm works and also can converge to the stationary point to help deep learning to do the parallel model training. So first, let's look at how can we design the distributed machine learning technique to solve the big data issue in deep neural network. So since around 2011, before 2011, the optimization technique are mainly deterministic technique. After 2011, in machine learning society, so we focus more on stochastic optimization, and also we know that Dr. Hinden improved the performance for deep neural network, they also use the stochastic gradient descent, which can sort of address the gradient vanishing problem. So with the stochastic gradient descent. We don't update the full gradient for a bare function. We can do the, we call the mini batch gradient. We every step, don't update all the gradient for the parameter. We randomly select a subset. For those subset parameters, we do the gradient. In this case, we can reduce the computational time. So in distributed learning, so far, most workers are still the centralized. So we have the parameter server. although we have a technical called decentralized distributed learning, that's the other story. So, but some technical can be transferred to the other side. So, let's talk about the now most popular use the centralized setup. We have a server. The server doesn't have the data. Server never stores data. Only do the computations. The data we call the data parallelization. Data are allocated into different worker. So different node, different worker has their own data. So they have different data. So when we train the model, for example, a deep neural network, the same deep neural network. So every location will compute there, do the mini-batch gradient descent to update their parameters. So after update the parameters, they will commute with the parameter server. So parameter server will base on the updating result to send back a feedback, the weight to the node. Node based on new updating new weights to the next round mini batch gradient descent. That's a general mechanism for distributed machine learning. However, in distributed machine learning, we can see that there exists a high competitions for between the servers and the workers, the nodes, the computational nodes, because if the workers convert slowly, then the worker will commute with the server many, many times. The communication overhead is very large. So we should avoid this challenge, this problem. Meanwhile, when we train the model, especially train the deep learning model, so for big data, meaning we always use a large batch training. So for large batch training, the convergence issue is still a challenging topic. So we are going to see how did we solve these two challenges in our recent work. So first, I will introduce three years ago work is asynchronous mini batch SBRT for non-convex optimization. So we did a multiple work on asynchronous distributed stochastic gradient descent algorithm. This SVRG based method is the first one. Obviously, we did for double stochastic gradient descent and also the dual problem distributed optimization and later for zero order. Because for some technique, we don't have gradient, so we can use zero order, the distributed zero order optimization to solve the model. And this year, we in our GMR paper, we provide a general framework to cover the distributed optimization. So the reason for me to pick up this asynchronous distributed SVRG technique is that this one is the first. It's our work to target especially for non-convex problem, because deep neural network is non-convex problem. So the SVRG based optimization can solve the deep neural network. So the first challenge, we want to reduce the communication overhead. So the basic way is to let each node converge fast. So we use the stochastic gradient with various reduction to improve the convergence. Then we need a fewer communication round. And meanwhile, we use asynchronous communication to reduce the waiting time. So that's our strategy to solve the first challenge. For the second challenge, we also provide theoretical analysis to improve the convergence rate for the distributed algorithm. Because when we in distributed machine learning, sometimes when we it's not very difficult to design algorithm, but the most difficult part is the theoretical analysis. We need to show that prove the convergence rate in the analysis. Oh, just one question about the SGD. For local minimal problem. Yeah, indeed, for SGD, because deep neural network is non-convex problem, we cannot find a global solution. So we always find the local solution. So sometimes people use the random restart, but now momentum based method. If we with adding momentum based strategy, we can jump out the settle point to get a better solution. Okay. So before we go to the technique, let's see some preliminaries. So in our technique, we start from the category gradient descent, because gradient descent update the full gradient. It takes a lot of computational cost. The time complexity for per iteration is high. So stochastic gradient descent will only consider every time a random update one coordinate. In parallel, if we have high dimension, we need using the, we call it stochastic coordinate descent method to update one feature, to select a random feature to update the parameters. So that's different. Actually, in our the other work, we did the double stochastic gradient descent to the gradient descent to the stochastic way for both big number and the big feature, a big number of features. For stochastic gradient descent, when they converge, they get a lot of noise when they go to the local minimum for non-convex problem. So so later around 2013, Tong Zhang's group proposed first using the virus reduction to improve the stochastic gradient descent convergence. They applied a good bound on that. So we can see this SVRG method. That's for single computer, not for distributed ways. For single computer, every m iterations, we get a model snapshot. That means we calculate one time for full gradient, and then we memorize this full gradient. So then after that, for every step of stochastic gradient, we use this full gradient. We remove the stochastic part because we randomly select a subset. Then we remove them from the full gradient. That means we use for the rest non-selected data point, we use the full gradient in the snapshot to recover part of gradient. Using this snapshot gradient, indeed we can improve the convergence. Oh, there's one question. Does map reduce work for this? Yeah, that's a very good question. I plan to talk in the next slide. For example, now we know we have Spark machine. We can use Spark machine to do that. But for all those, for this technique, they only work for the same IP segment. So you can consider the Spark system could be a worker in our system. We do what we call the parameter server. Is the parameter server, especially for cloud computing, they use this technique. So the computer, the cluster, we could have multiple, many small clusters. They are in different location in the world. They don't need to locate in the same IP segment. So for memory, they say like based on Spark based method, they have to using the same IP segment to limit to the specific small cluster or for specific region. For parameter server, for distributed machine learning, you can consider as a higher level of computing, can use much more resource to do the much larger scale of computing. So this is standard, this SVRG method for sequential algorithm. Then when we do design the distributed algorithm, we need to consider there is a communication between worker and server. We need to design both algorithm for worker and server. And also, especially we need to provide the theoretical analysis to show the convergence guarantee for our algorithm. So when we talk about the distributed machine learning, actually we have to talk about two ways. One way we call the synchronized communication. So synchronized communication is that the server, every iteration, the server will wait all the workers. But we know that different workers, their computation speed are different. So the waiting time could be very long for certain worker. Then to delay the whole process. Of course, in a local setup, if we guarantee all the workers are very fast, so the synchronous communication is still okay. But when the system go to large scale, we cannot guarantee all the workers are very fast. And also some workers could corrupt. Now send it back. Then this synchronous communication, the synchronous distributed machine learning method could stuck there. For asynchronous communication, so the server doesn't wait for the worker computation. So when one worker send an update, then the server will automatically update the coordinates, and then send back the gradient. So we don't wait any worker. So we after get an update from worker, the central server will update the parameter, update the model, and send back a gradient. So this asynchronous ways can remove all the waiting time. So dramatically improve the computation, improve the efficiency of computational time. So that's the reason for it. We use the asynchronous communication. So we always use asynchronous communication. However, asynchronous communication makes the algorithm more difficult, especially the proof become more difficult because every step we use delayed gradient. The gradient, when we calculate gradient, the gradient may already be updated by other workers. Oh, there's one question about asynchronous, we all call the bias in estimation. No, it's based on the estimator. Some of them, they are biased, some are unbiased estimation. So that's a base. So we do have the bias, the estimation method and the unbiased. So for asynchronous itself, they may not introduce the bias. For distributed optimization, if we consider the memory architecture, we have two ways. One is called the shared memory architecture. For example, the multi-thread, like for multi-thread, for the same cluster or computer, we have many threads. Typically, we call it parallel computing. So all the threads, they share the memory. So that means they are in the local. But this is also very often used in cluster, small cluster. The distributed memory architecture is the one we use for parameter server. For parameter server, the server, each server could be a Spark system. They are located anywhere in the world. Okay, they just commute through the internet with the parameter server to update the technique. So each individual worker has their own own W. So that means the own parameters, and they have their own data, and also the memory, they have their own memory. But for shared memory architecture, they share the memory and they share the same W. That means when we update W for shared memory, there could have the delay. We should consider this situation. So when we design this algorithm, we need to consider both architecture, okay? Because the algorithm design has some slight different. So first, let's see how did we design the shared memory architecture algorithm. So for shared memory architecture, when suppose one thread at one iteration, one thread to read the parameter, the current parameter from the current parameter in the memory. If we read this memory, we should consider after we read the memory, other worker could update that. So historically, multiple algorithm like the earliest one is the G6 work, and later he has the other work at 2015. They use this technique. They consider if we have the delayed upper bound, so we consider multiple iterations in previous update in the memory. We use this updating difference to compensate the delay for the memory, but it's an approximation. But with this one, we can get better proof we can improve the bound in the little proof. So after we read this, we call it the model the parameter. So we calculate we use the SVRG gradient descent calculate for each thread. So after that, we need to update after we get this the SVRG gradient. We select we only select one item to update in the memory because we cannot write the whole memory. Every time we have to update atom wise. So we select one that's for one parameter in the memory. So we update that. Then we calculate next one. So that's just for internal iteration. We do many times. Then after M iterations, we need to go outside to update this snapshot because this snapshot is the full gradient for the SVRG update. We need to update the SVRG, then go to the internal go to the internal updating. Just a shared memory based SVRG asynchronous SVRG algorithm. So then we need to prove the convergence for our algorithm. So we do use the basic assumptions. For example, the data are independent, and also it's unbiased gradient for stochastic gradient. And also we consider gradient its Lipschitz continuous. And also the delay, we have the maximum time delay. We don't consider the infinity time. So that we know that there is a delay, but we have the bound. We know the bound. Actually, this one can be calculated in the real system. Then we use a lemma to bound the updating of the SVRG gradient. We can get our theorem. So we prove that for our gradient, this one will has a sublinear relation. But this here we have a linear rate. So then later we bound this linear rate for the same equation. Actually, we can write as a new bound. Upper bound without linear rate. So B is the size of the batch. T is the total iteration numbers. So that means our algorithm is sublinear, has a sublinear conversion rate. So that's for shared memory algorithm. So for the distributed asynchronous distributed SVRG algorithm, we also need a design for the distributed memory. Not for shared memory. For distributed memory, it's similar, but we should consider there's a worker. For every worker, it also has delayed gradient. And we need to design the third part of algorithm and the worker side algorithm. Oh, there's one question. Oh, the current rate baseline. Yeah, the current baseline. Yeah, that's a good question. So current baseline is before our work is big O, 1 over square root of T. So we improve to the big O, 1 over T. So we do have the improvement. So for each worker we consider, we can use the delayed gradient to calculate, using the snapshot to calculate this SVRG gradient. And then we send update to the server. Server will update the parameter and then send back the new updated parameter for each worker. So each worker will update that. So the server node algorithm, mainly they will calculate, they will update every time get the new gradient, SVRG gradient, they will update the parameters, then send back a parameter. After get a parameter, then if we use the flag, it's true, that means we need to update the snapshot gradient. If it's false, that means we need to keep updating the SVRG gradient. Actually, we should notice that if the worker has less computational power, so actually we only need to calculate the first term. For the two later term, actually, because we already sent it to the server, the two later term actually can be moved to this equation to be updated at the server node. So that means this algorithm can be has alternative way. We can decide that based on the computational power of the worker node and the server node, which one is powerful can do more computations. So similarly, we also can prove for this asynchronous distributed memory algorithm. we also have this it's a sublinear conversion rate. So we improve from Lien's paper. In Lien's paper, they have the 1/1 square root t. In our paper, we improve the 1/1 t. But we should consider this is distributed machine learning. So we could add many workers on that. If we have improved many more workers, we could get a linear speed up. So from this figure, we can see the ideal case, if we improve the thread, like in shared memory, we improve thread. In distributed architecture, a memory architecture, we improve the number of worker. We should have similar to the linear is speed up. But in our paper, we get, because we have the communication overhead, so we cannot get the idea in speed up, but indeed the speed up increase. When we add the number of threads, that's mean, although it's a sublinear conversion rate, but if we consider the distributed mechanism, the speed up will be much faster. So we also show that our method is better than the traditional stochastic gradient descent method. So, but in practice, at the first several iterations, we always using SGD, because at the beginning, actually SGD is faster. After multiple iterations, we run SVRG to get better convergence. So the combination of them will be get the best performance. That's, now it's well known in machine learning society. This experiment is for the the first one is for the for shared memory. This second experiment I show here is for the distributed memory. We implemented the convolutional neural network. We use a fully connected layer for convolutional neural network. Then we use the Cypher 10, and in the paper we also show the Cypher 100 data set for experiments. We compare our SVRG the speed up with the standard, compared with the standard the SGD method, and we use the redo activation function. So besides this work, actually in recent years, since last year, I think in community we use more the spider, we call spider method. Spider method is also a kind of various reduction technique. Using spider method, we can further improve this asynchronous distributed algorithm. And also this year we have the other work we add the momentum based method. The first paper was published by a group at last year, NeurIPS. They proposed what they call storm method. Using storm method, that means we add momentum to this existing sequential or distributed algorithm. We can further improve the convergences. For momentum based method, although sometimes we cannot improve the theoretical bound, but indeed for a practical case, we could speed up the algorithms. When we do the big data training for deep neural network, we have the other issue. It comes from the large batch, because for large batch, when we do the, if we run deep neural network for huge data, we have to use very large batch, very large, to get a better speed. Otherwise, it will be very slow. However, these methods are not well understood, so there are no theoretical proof. They only have traditional algorithm. Actually, now most popular methods they call last method, but it's different to the last as in statistics. It's not a discrete angle regression. It's called layer-wise rate scaling. So they have the same acronym, but the methods are different. This is the last method plus warm up to improve the training speed. However, they don't have the theoretical proof to support the method. Meanwhile, the warm up trick, sometimes they cannot find the good convergence speed. So we need to further improve this algorithm. So first, let's see the if we train like a ResNet 50, it's very popular. ResNet is very popular user deep neural network method. You would train that on ImageNet with the batch size 256, it takes about 29 hours. if we increase the byte size, the 32K, so it takes 2.2 minutes. So we can see that with the large batch training, the deep neural network can be dramatically increased. In the layer-wide adaptive rate scaling method, they consider for every layer, they adaptive linear rate. If they use the same linear rate for all the layers, the training will be very slow. Sometimes could diverge. They use adaptive linear rate for every layer. However, at the beginning, they need to call it warm up. Warm up means they multiply a coefficient. They have to start from zero, very small step, till to certain epoch. After that, multiple epochs, they can do the adaptive linear rate. So it's a very heuristic algorithm. It works very good, but it's very heuristic without any theoretical support. So this year in one of our work, we proved that first we extend the Lipschitz continuous to each layers. So the key thought is that we don't consider we have the global the Lipschitz continuous assumption, and we also have for each layer. Then each layer has their own Lipschitz constant. Meanwhile, for bounded variance, we also bound for every layer, so that's reasonable. However, they introduce the difficulty in proof because we have every layer we have the Lipschitz constant. Okay? To deal with this, we did some trick in our proof. Then we show that it's the first time to show that for this last algorithm, it has some linear conversion rate. Okay, and also we show that the linear rate is bounded by the Lipschitz constant here. So that means when we design the neural network training method, actually we can design the upper bound for the linear rate to improve the linear speed. So that means the when we design algorithm, we can directly optimize the linear rate. So in previous paper, in the last paper, they did some many experiments. It's a very empirical paper. They did experiment to show that for every layers, for convolutional neural network, for every layers, they calculate this the scaling. Actually, every they consider the scaling for the linear rate. Actually, this one can be approximated by the norm of the gradient of the of each layer. They calculate these values, the scaling rate. Actually, they found that in later layers, they have much larger one than previous layers. Okay, actually, this is considered as warm up trick, because for warm up trick, if we calculate this the bound the variation to bound linear rate, we can see that at the first if we increase the layers for later layers. This variation number is much larger than previous layers. That means for women for warm up, they consider for the later layer don't know more much at the beginning. Okay, we only start the training improve the training for the first we train more at the beginning layers. Okay, we limit the bit change in the deep layers. It's like a freeze them. Okay, then gradually. After warm up, so we can use adaptive linear rate to get a better to train the model better. So in our work, we call the complete layer-wise adaptive rate scaling. Actually, we introduced one term. So we run at this formulation to help attendees to understand that actually this term and this term can be canceled to each other. So in our algorithm, we only have this term as dominator. So that's this term actually indeed gradually changed the difference because originally they use the Lipschitz constant to bound to normalize this the norm of the parameter. Actually, we consider using the variance bound to normalize that. Actually, using this one, we can get rid of the warm up mechanism. So that means we don't need to use heuristic weights like warm up first and do the large batch training. So we show the experiments. Indeed, we also prove that our algorithm has a sublinear conversion rate. So then we compare our method with the existing last method with warm up. We can see that we get a much better the accuracy with the APO training. Okay, we don't need warm up. We can improve the performance. Okay. And also, if we using the train on the internet with the batch very large, we can show that we have much faster to get the converged training loss compared to the state of the art, the last method. Yeah, just a question about the batch size training. Yeah, indeed, the small batch size could give better convergence, but just for the local side. But when the data very large, at the beginning we need using very large batch size to improve the training speed. Okay. Actually, that's a similar intuition for this for the last paper. They proposed to use adaptive learning rate. For different layers, to improve the convergence speed. So that's how do we design technique to deal with the big data training? Then the deep learning has very large model. That's different to the big data. For big data, we can consider using the large batch training, and we can distribute data to allocate them to different worker. To simultaneously compute that using asynchronous distributed algorithm to solve the problem. However, meanwhile, besides large data, we also have a big model. So for deep neural network, we can see even around past 2 years, so the standpoint actually is very high, is billions of parameters. But in past 2 years, the model size is increasing much, much larger. We can say now that we have is almost I think the newest model is more than 20 billion of parameters. It takes years to train the model. For such a large model, there's no way to compute them in one GPU. So that definitely. So usually we need to come like a first 100 layer, we compute in GPU one, the second 100 layer, we compute in the GPU two. For the third GPU, we compute the other 100 layers. So then we can do model parallelization, right? Then people can say, okay, it's easy to do model parallelization. However, that's not true. So let's see, for deep neural network, we always using the back propagation. Even we use the stochastic gradient descent, we call the back propagation to calculate to get a gradient for every layers. Like for example, we have three layers. We have the loss function, right? We need to do the gradient for individual layers. When we calculate this gradient, so let's say for following, we just this parameter we already including both the regression and also the active function parameter. We put them together. So we for forward it's easy. We just do the regression and active function, right? But for back propagation. When we do the backward propagation, first in the layer three, we need to we distribute the error on the parameters. So on the parameters and also on the input, okay. And for the layer two, we calculate this the errors. But for these errors, we need using for the partial gradient on H. H is the input of the input of layer three. The output of layer two. So, but this for the partial gradient, partial gradient error on the H2 actually was computed at layer three. So that means if layer three doesn't send this value, for layer two we have to wait. We have to wait. Similarly, for layer one, when layer one calculates the gradient, we need to calculate the error, the partial derivative of the error on H1. H1 is the output of layer one, is the input of layer two. But this one is calculated at the layer two. So in backup propagation, that means for each layer, they have to wait for each other. Without the backup propagated errors, for the later layer, they can do nothing. They have to wait. So that means even we parallelize them to many, many GPUs, okay? But the each layer, they have to wait for each other. They cannot do computing in parallel. So that means there is no parallelization. We just use different GPU to hold them. There are no, for computational, there are no parallelization, okay? So that's because that's what we call the backward locking. The backward propagation method lock the competition between layers. So each layer has to wait for the other layers. So then we cannot parallelize the competitions. So there's no way to do that. So then we think about this problem. Okay, then we don't want the model is too large. We have to train in multiple GPU. And we want to all the GPU to compute simultaneously. Don't wait. And indeed, there are also intuitive ways to do that. But and we need a theoretical proof of the algorithm can converge. Okay, that's the other challenge. So let's see our method. First, we propose we call it decoupled parallel back propagation. So for this method, we break the back propagation lock in the back propagation algorithm. Okay, then we can and then we provide the theoretical analysis to prove the conversion rate. So actually, this problem exists in literature for many years. So many previous work try to solve them. For example, in the decoupled neural network, they consider before we wait for the back propagation gradient, we can do some synthetic gradient. They use the other model, could be the other deep neural network or the other model to learn synthetic gradient to train that. Yeah, however, these models often doesn't converge because there are no way to prove this converge. Actually, in experiments, we show that this method often doesn't converge. The other method was proposed around 2016. They call it, it's a direct feedback alignment. They consider, okay, so when we get errors, we don't back propagate. We directly distribute to all the layers. Okay, then we avoid the backward locking. However, we know that the error for each layer is different. So we have for this way, we definitely, the algorithm has no way to converge. So all existing effort failed. So then we think about how can we break this dependence between different layers? So because when we need this gradient for H1, but it exists in the layer two. So we have no way to get them before layer two pass to layer one. So then we think about, okay, but when we do the training, actually we train many, many wrong. Okay, we don't have the current gradient on the H1, but we do have gradient for previous time. We can use the historical gradient. Actually, this similar idea appears in optimization history. Okay, actually, at the beginning, I think even 20 years ago, some people already have similar idea to do the unit delayed gradient. Okay, using historical gradient to optimize the deep neural network. But nobody can prove this method really works. Because if we use a historical gradient, we cannot guarantee the convergence. So they could diverge. Actually, when we designed this method at the beginning, we also didn't think that the method will work. But after we do experiments, we see that, okay, we do have a convergent result. Then we developed the theoretical analysis to show that, okay, that yeah, this algorithm is correct. So, For example, for layer three, so we have the errors, we can do the gradient. So there is no problem. But for layer two, when we do the gradient, we didn't get the T iteration, the current iteration for gradient. Okay, so during the waiting time, we don't stop, we keep computing. When we keep computing, we use the last iteration gradient to calculate that. Okay. Then similarly for layer one, we still do the same, but we two layer behind, so we use two iteration two iterations ago gradient to calculate this the gradient, the sort of scatter gradient for the model. So that means for every layer, we don't wait for other we don't wait for from other modules. So in the real implementation, we split, if we have many layers, okay, like 300 layers, we can split them into different modules. Here I demonstrate unit 12 layers. Suppose because every GPU can hold many layers, okay, so we can put the layers together into many layers in one GPU, like in one module. Every module they are computed in one GPU. So then every layer when we calculate gradient, we use the historical gradient value to keep computing. So when we do the computing, we get a keep receiving a new gradient from previous module. So then we just keep doing that. So we do this decoupled delayed gradient. So when the training complete, we can get a convert result. Actually, this algorithm for our delayed gradient. Actually, the algorithm very simple. The most difficult part is this proof. We still use the Lipschitz continuous and the bounded for gradient. And if the step size, okay, if we have fixed step size for the learning, then we show that our algorithm will converge to a region close to the optimal solution, not exactly, but close to the optimal solution with sublinear convergence speed. If we use the step size, if we pick up step size with the diminishing sequence, then we can show that our algorithm actually can converge to the stationary point for the optimal solution of deep neural network. That's when we have the same convergence rate and convert to the optimal solution for deep neural network. That means we can train a good neural network without losing the convergence speed. But indeed, we will lose a little bit of accuracy, but not much. So we conduct experiments using the Cypher 10 and Cypher 100, and we did on the convolution multiple neural network. For example, we use the RED network in next several slides. We compare it to the existing DNI method. For this DNI method, they often they don't converge. Okay, so our method indeed we can count for both training and testing. We have very similar convergence speed with the backpropagation. The black line is the backpropagation. The convergence very similar to the backpropagation. Okay, but that's for the if we split like a. We show that on if we split two position or split more than two position, the DNI method doesn't converge. But our method indeed has a very similar convergence with the backpropagation. That means we can do very good training, similar to as the traditional backpropagation method. And then if we still on one GPU, okay, because on one GPU, if we do the parallelization, we want to improve much, but still we can improve a little bit on the computational time. But if we use the four GPU, we can see that if we use the four GPU, we conduct experiments on the ResNet 100, we split it into the four GPU. So we can see that if we use one GPU, that's the computational time. Then with increasing the number of GPU, the computational time will be dramatically reduced because we reduce the back propagation time, so we can improve the speed. However, for this method, indeed we do have one problem because in previous figure, if you remember, we install a lot of historical gradient. Okay, we use quite a large of storage. Okay, so in our later paper, we improve that. So we don't store, we only store the gradient for one layer. For the rest layer, we don't store all the values. So we use this, when we calculate for every, in the delayed gradient calculation, so we use the first layer, because we have the current W, we directly use the W to approximate the current gradient for each. So then we use several new computation to replace all the storage. So then we can dramatically reduce the space complexity. So in deep learning, the RNN formulation is similar, is minimize the loss and with the activity functions constraint. Actually, in our new formulation, we can consider actually so we besides minimize the final loss, we minimize for every layer, we minimize the delayed gradient error. So to have understanding, so we can see that in backward propagation, this data get an exact solution because every layer they wait for each other, we can get the real gradient result. So in previous decoupled neural interface method, they use synthetic gradient. So this one often is not correct. In our first decoupled delayed gradient, we use the previous layer gradient to the previous iteration gradient to approximate that. So in the second version of our algorithm, we call the feature replay method. In feature replay method, so we don't use the multiple iteration before gradient. We use the current parameter to recalculate this value. So to improve the storage, the space complexity. So meanwhile, we also prove that we can guarantee our congruency. We also have with the fixed linear rate and the dimension linear rate, we have the sublinear congruent rate. Actually, we also show that in our proof, we do have one assumption. This assumption that is we need a sufficient direction. The sufficient direction is that our calculated gradient, the expectation for our current gradient, compared with the full gradient. That means the species gradient for the for deep neural network. So we can find a constant to bound that. So that's it's easy to satisfy. For example, if we use the ResNet 101, 101 layers, we can see that we have a positive value for this sigma value. So we definitely this sigma exists. Actually, we can see that. So at the beginning, this sigma is a smaller value. That means our gradient indeed is very similar to the fastest gradient for full gradient for the neural network. That means it will convert very fast at the beginning epochs. And then later on, this value become larger, close to one. That means our value will be different to the fastest gradient. That means because it goes to the local, very close to the optimal solution, which we slow down to find to get a better convergence. So in experiments, we show that when we using different number of GPU, we can improve the computational speed. And for our feature replay method, we get a similar space complexity storage at the back propagation. So we won't increase much on storage, but we can increase a lot so on the computational time. But indeed, for our first version of decoupled delay gradient method, we can improve the computational time, but the space complexity is quite high. So that's why we designed a second algorithm to solve this problem. So we conduct experiments for multiple deep neural networks. We can show that for our feature replay method, we can get even better the testing errors. So we can consider when we add more layers in different GPUs, it's similar to the add regularization to the deep neural networks. So that means we can even reduce the overfitting issues. We can improve the predicting results. Thank you very much to listen to my talk. Yeah, this is the collaboration work with my student Zhou Yanghuo and my postdoc Bing Gu. So please send me your question. Yeah, it's my pleasure to answer questions.
We we're just about out of time, but if there are any last questions, you can submit them to the chat now. We have a question. Can the assumption of the Lipschitz continuous gradient be relaxed? For example, locally Lipschitz continuous. And do we often have Lipschitz continuous gradient in practice?
In practice, we do have this. This is assumption satisfy in practice. So that is no problem. If we want to relate to the local, it depends. For our current algorithm, for current proof, we don't need to relate to the local Lipschitz constant. But I think if with this assumption, there is possible to design a more aggressive algorithm. But the proof, the theoretical analysis will depend on. It's not a guarantee yet, but it could be a good try. But we didn't try that yet.
Okay, well, I think we're going to wrap up now. So thanks, Hung, for joining us today, for sharing your expertise with us, and for your thoughtful responses to all the questions. To our viewers, we would appreciate you sharing any feedback you have or suggestions about how we can improve this online seminar. On the Distinguished Seminar Series page on the Purdue Statistics website, you can find a link where you can share your thoughts with us. The seminar series will continue next Friday, and we hope that you'll all join us again for the next lecture.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Appreciate it.
Thank you.